Hello and welcome to The Quest on Rajya Sabha TV. I'm Rakhee Bakshee. This show gives you a deep insight into the life, career and vision of a leading personality. And that leading personality this week is an ace double trap shooter, a very acclaimed sportsperson of India. His name is Mr. Ronjan Sodhi. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
It's great to have you here. But initially, the basic question I want to ask you, why shooters now are doing so well in India?
Well, there is not any one specific reason that I can point out here, but there are a number of reasons why shooters are doing well. See, primarily, there is a lot of support from the government, and there's a lot
of... You mean to say other sports are not getting that much support?
No, they are. But since the shooters have been doing well in Commonwealth Games, Asian Games, and see Olympics, so there is a lot of government funding because they realize that this is one sport in India which can fetch them medals at the highest level.
Okay.
So that is one reason. So,
and why do you think in India shooting is doing well?
See, I feel that as Indians and our body type is good for skill sports, say it's archery or shooting. You know, it's difficult for us in sports like athletics or swimming to match the Europeans.
Okay.
Because maybe the physical structure is not...
Fitness levels, you
fitness
mean.
Level is there, but the physical structure, you say a height of an average Indian to compare it to a height of an average German, you know, it's not there. So, end of the day, I think in skill sports, we'll be world beaters as compared to the other sports. And this is one reason why, if you see sports like archery and shooting have been doing well over the last few years.
Congratulations that you won Khel Ratna, and that is a very an award which is really acclaimed for a sports person in India. But of course, it had its share of shadow. I mean, you know, all kinds of talks happened. How would you look at it?
Well, I guess obviously it doesn't go in the best light. I guess an award without any controversy would have been better. But nevertheless, it gives a bad picture, especially to the youngsters. Because end of the day, you get awards, you know, for your achievements, and you really can't go and ask for awards.
Yeah.
So it gives a very bad picture.
So why there is a feeling that one actually asks or manages awards? I mean, why there is this feeling now?
I guess the sports ministry now have come up with a new policy, you know, wherein they have a point system. So there is going to be some clarity, some transparency, which should have been there much before. So at least there's going to be some clarity now. And see, initially the awards used to be decided by the sports ministry and sports authority of India. So then there was a change wherein they had a panel of 15 eminent sports personalities from different parts of India and different sports, and to decide upon who the awardee is going to be. But there were some controversies even in that. So now there's a clear-cut point system, I think, and this is going to bring in a lot of transparency in the awards.
How was your feeling, first of all, when all this controversy was happening and finally when you got it? How would you look at that time?
Well, I wasn't really concerned about it. If I were to say I should have got this award in 2011 or 2010, wherein I almost won every competition I took part in, I never said anything. And when I got it and when my name was announced, I was very happy. But the entire thing around, I think it was just overhyped rather than anything else. So, but it didn't really bother me.
How do you look at this whole phenomena, Mr. Sodhi, when something like sports, which is based basically on talent and merit, gets into such kind of thought and talk and controversy?
I mean, guess, sad. Yeah, I guess if, you know, especially sports people, you know, senior sports people, if they can stay away from all this, it will be definitely good for our youngsters. It gives a very bad picture to the juniors, you know, if we start indulging ourselves in such controversies. So I guess every senior sports person should stay away from all these controversies.
And now let's look at you and how you started it. How did you start becoming a shooter? When did you start training? How did this idea come about?
Well, I started quite late, and when I started, there were many hurdles as compared to somebody who wants to get into shooting now. There was only one range in northern India, which was Dr. Karni Singh shooting range.
Okay.
I happened to be studying in Delhi. I belong to Punjab, a place called Ferozpur. So I was studying here in Delhi. I was in boarding school here. So one day my dad came to meet me on a weekend and he says, would you like to go to the shooting range? And I said, why not? So I just went to the range, and just fascinated me the way I saw shooters shooting this flank clear targets and everything, I was completely fascinated. And I asked my dad if I could, shoot as a hobby on weekends. Mm. So he had some friends who organized Sunday shoots for me. So I used to just go on Sundays and shoot. It was just like a hobby. Never realized then that this
very surprising that from a hobby actually to becoming such an acclaimed shooter, because it requires quite a amount of training and rigorous training, I would say.
Exactly. See, for sports to be your career wasn't a very lucrative that point of time. I'm talking about 97, 98. Okay. So sports was never looked at as a very lucrative career option. So only in 2004 actually, when Colonel Rajyavardhan Rathore won the silver medal, that the sport got a lot of attention. Yeah. Only after that, me and a lot of other shooters realized that,
it can be
looked at as a career option. So kind of took it a little seriously after that. And I'm very happy, with my where my career has taken me so far.
So how has this journey been in the sense that, from taking it up as a hobby to now getting Khel Ratna, coming down to,
Yeah, well, when I started shooting, I could never imagine that that point of time, just to be part of the Indian shooting team used to be a big thing for me. But I never realized that one day I'll be getting the highest sportsman award, and I feel really happy and feel really humbled to have received such a high honor.
So there's so much that we still want to talk to you about, but right now you're watching Quest and we are in conversation with Mr. Ronjan Sodhi. We'll keep talking to him, but don't go away. We're coming back very shortly. Welcome back to the Quest. You're watching this conversation with Mr. Ronjan Sodhi and we are talking to him about sports in general and shooting in particular. Talking about sports scene in India, there are so many challenges that one is looking at and facing also. As sports persons, one has to, when you talk about resources, there is none or minimal. How would you look at the sports scene? When compared internationally, we really not fair.
We really can't compare the sports scenario in India to the European countries and America. But definitely there is a lot of change from what I've seen, in my shooting career. Yeah. And we are a long way far from becoming a strong sporting nation. What is needed is a culture for sports, which I feel does not exist in India. The whole sporting culture is not there. I think it's going to take a lot of time for that to happen. Mm. But a big change which I've seen, especially in Delhi, was the Commonwealth Games. Mm. After Commonwealth Games, a lot of people started talking about sports.
Yeah.
They would encourage their children to go for some sports or the other. Mm. So there was a positive change, especially in Delhi. What is needed is in rural areas. We have to go to the grassroots level to bring about the entire
We change. Don't have facilities, for example, to forget about stadiums. We don't have even sporting fields and children can go and play, things like that.
Well, more than that, even the stadiums are required. Okay, sports like football or cricket can be played anywhere, but specialized stadiums for shooting, you really can't go and shoot anywhere unless you have a proper stadium, you have proper guns and everything. So, these sports are still far from, from what it should be, ideally.
I'll go a little further. A lot of expectations from the government, and what we saw recently in all this embarrassment which happened at the international level. How would you look at it? How do you think the government should be dealing with it?
Well, the government, I would say, is doing a fantastic job. I can tell you about myself. I am a product of the system. But the problem is, to reach that level, once you reach that level, you have all kind of facilities, whatever you want, and there's a lot of support from the government, from the corporate, from the federation. But the problem is how to reach that level. There are a lot of hurdles there.
No, for example, when IOC points out and saying that there are irregularities and, there are political interference in terms of handling political posts in a sports scenario.
Well, I would always say that not only me, every sports person of this country would want a clean sport bodies, but nothing wrong with it. So, I guess there was an issue and I'm very sure that it's going to be resolved soon and we'll be able to...
Do you hear something is happening? We are expecting that something should happen sooner because February 9th is the Winter Olympics.
I hope so that you know, our four athletes who are going there could represent under the tricolor. But nevertheless, don't forget, these kind of things do happen, you know, in countries. And but we must all stand by it. And, you know,
no, what's your personal take on politicians, for example, heading sports bodies? I mean, this is something that, okay, I guess that is being talked about.
I guess there has to be a mix. You can't have sports bodies to be just totally run by sports people. We don't have the experience to run, we don't have administrative experience. It will be a flop if you make all sports persons run sport bodies. So there has to be a mix.
So you feel that sports persons can't make for very good, let's say, heads of sports bodies, or can't manage?
Because all our life we've never been in administration. We've spent all our time on the sport fields and everything. Mm. How do you expect us to run a body wherein you require expertise in administration? We can't do that. Mm. So there has to be a mix. As far as the role of sports persons are concerned, I think in selection of the team is where we can play a big role. Then you need professional people to market your sport, which will definitely be from the corporates. Then also you need politicians, because see, end of the day, don't forget, maximum funding comes from the government. So if a federation is headed by a politician, it is easier for that person to speak to the higher senior government officer or to the minister level people, or for even, for example, even a small thing like getting visas. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of small things.
But how, like, for example, we see in BCCI, ex-cricketer, somebody with experience kind of gets...
See, they're self-funded. You know, they don't ask for funding from the government or any other person. So they're self-funded. And don't forget, cricket is more than a sport. It's become it's bigger than anything else in
it's
in
a
India.
Religion in India.
Yeah, so we really can't compare cricket and other sports at the moment.
How would you like other sports, as you're talking about, to come up? I mean, there are so many other Indian sports which need to come up. What's your take on that?
Well, if you've seen in Punjab, the Punjab government took initiative and they started organizing this Kabaddi World Cup, which has become a huge, huge success. Okay. And most of the matches are conducted in the rural stadiums and everything, and not in the cities. And it's something which people wait for. People in Punjab wait for the Kabaddi World Cup. It's a huge success. So unless we take the sports to the masses, you know, in small towns and villages, it'll never become popular.
Has to be a movement. I mean, right now, you know, for example, cinema is looking at it. There's so many other mediums which are looking at it. How do you like, for example, cinema taking it up? There are so many players on whose lives now filmmakers are looking at.
There's a movie coming up on Mary Kom's life. Yeah. And Bhag Milka Bhag was an amazing movie. So there is a move towards sports, and there is a step to give recognition to all these sports people who've made us proud, made our country proud. So there is a positive change, but you can't expect overnight things to change. Obviously, it's going to take its time.
And in the parliament, one was looking at the sports bill. How would you look at this whole bill as such?
Well, there's nothing wrong in it. And to be very frank, to be with you, I haven't really gone through the entire thing. Yeah. For a little bit, as a, like a layman, I can talk about, there's nothing wrong in it, I guess.
Mm-hmm. And what are your thoughts in the future of our sports? I mean, how would you look at a certain kind of pattern in sports? For example, now shooters, as we discussed, they are being recognized. We have even rural sports, like as you mentioned, Kabaddi is coming up. How would you look at the future of sports in India?
See, there has to be some kind of security. Now, what happens is somebody who's out of school, into college and doing well in sports. Now, a lot of parents start worrying about their jobs, their future, because end of the day, a lot of people still think that it's like a gamble. If you don't make it big, then what? If you don't finish your studies and if you don't take a job, and then you'll be at 28, 29 without a job, and what do you do? So when you're out of college, there has to be some kind of security for the parents, so that they feel, okay, their girl or their boy has something to fall back on. Mm-hmm. So I guess government should come up with some schemes or give them jobs, in more jobs. Okay, there's still public sector is doing a great job by giving jobs, but it's still, I would say, it's less. So there has to be more jobs offered in to the sports persons, whether in armed services, armed forces, or on the police or various other
You mean to say that will also boost? That is an incentive.
Because then you don't leave. Otherwise, today after college, you're pushed into going and working for something else rather than pursuing your career, because you really don't generate, or you don't make any money, you know, by playing in, by going and representing even your state. There's hardly any money to make.
Okay. So there's so much more still that we want to talk to you about, and we are in conversation right now with Mr. Ranjan Sodhi. We'll continue to talk to him, but right now we are taking a very short break. So you're watching The Quest, and we are in conversation with Mr. Ronjan Sodhi. You know, we feel sad and unfortunate that things like doping charges and all happen. How do you look at that? I mean, sad scenario.
Yeah, well, it's not the very best thing to hear. But, you know, I guess there's a lot of ignorance.
And how do you look at the complexities? For example, sometimes a big name comes up and, you know, maybe it gets cleared after some time, but there is this whole controversy with dogs.
I guess, there is a lot of ignorance. You know, a lot of athletes don't know exactly what to take, what supplement to take. So they have to be educated about this. Sports science is something which has to be looked at in India, and which is still a area which has to be developed.
Mm-hmm.
So this is something which is lacking.
Okay, well, of course, these are some of the concerns. Talking about your achievements, I mean, you know, I was looking at your medals, and it's like huge tally altogether. How have been the experiences? For example, Commonwealth, Asian Games, or ISSF. You've been doing well.
Well, it's been a great journey.
Which was the most enjoyable moment, for example, for you?
Well, the first medal, which is obviously the most difficult to win, you know, but because once you break that barrier, then things become easy, because you start believing in abilities that, you know, if you've done it once, you could do it again. So the first medal is the most difficult medal, so which was in 2007 in Santo Domingo, in a World Cup where I got a bronze medal. So after that, the going's been good, and I hope to continue this till Rio the Olympics.
Okay, and how was London? You just missed it.
Well, London was a great eye-opener for me. It was my first games, and I went in as one of the favorites, which is not an easy thing. I was ranked world number 2 at that point of time, so there were a lot of expectations from everyone in this country, from the media, from friends, from family. So I went there with a, you know, a lot of expectations. I tried to stay away from the entire, you know, glory and everything, but then back of your mind,
there's this pressure somewhere.
I mean, I don't want to call it pressure, but then there are expectations of people, and, you know, even you have to prove yourself, you know, that you're good enough to win, because everybody's high hopes at you. So I started off well in the first round. In fact, I was leading. And the first round is the most difficult round, you know, especially of my first Olympics and going as a favorite. I was shivering before the round, but I shot really well. Even after the second round, I was lying number 4th. But just towards the end, I don't know what happened in the last 6 shots. I missed 4 out of the 6, which is very unusual. We don't even do it on really, really bad days.
Okay.
And I still remember that moment, and I couldn't believe that, you know, something which was right there and not there then. So those 2-3 minutes just took that whole thing away. Mm-hmm. Obviously, there were finals, but I was sure once I was in the final, because over the last few years, my biggest strength was the finals.
You know, I'm just reminded of this Milkha Singh episode also. Is there a moment where something ticks, I mean, you know, and, you know, when you're just on the verge of actually on the victory line, so to say?
Yeah, you have to keep yourself composed and everything, and obviously there are these moments, and, you know, shooting is absolutely as a mental sport. It's 80% of the game is between the ears.
Yeah, in fact, talk about shooting as a sport, because so many viewers who are watching would like to know what it needs to become a good shooter.
See, obviously, you need to have a good technique, and you have to have the best of the equipment, and, you know, you have to be solid in your technique. But more than that, end of the day, it's just your state of mind that particular day which will make you win that medal or you lose that medal.
Mm-hmm.
So most important thing which a shooter as a quality should have is self-belief. I think if you believe in your abilities, there's nothing that you can't achieve.
And how much does a coach matter?
Coach does matter as far as the technique is concerned. We also work with psychologists and everything. But to have a positive attitude when you're competing is the most important thing. You have to be really positive and fight till the last target.
So what's, for example, a routine that one has to follow in terms of regimen? That, for example, if you're preparing for a big sporting event, what is it required?
Well, it requires everything. Right from going to a sports psychologist before your competition, to spending time with your physio so that there's no injury, or if there are little injuries, to be in the best of physical shapes during the competition, and to work on your technique so that your technique is absolutely solid. Your equipment has to be in absolute order. So it requires everything. There's not one particular thing which you need to train to go into a big competition. So there's an entire team that you have to work with, the entire team at the same time for about 15 days or 20 days just before the competition, so that you go in there strong.
And how has the family been supporting?
Well, that's very important. Family support is very important, and I've been very fortunate that they've always stood by me, because we travel a lot. In 1 year, we're traveling from 7 to 8 months. You know, at times before the Olympics, I was abroad probably 7 months. That's one area, you know, where you need a lot of support.
Mm-hmm. You know, we talk to the ministers concerned. I mean, the sports ministry, they have a lot of plans, and they keep saying that, you know, these are the things one is moving ahead with, and these are the plans and schemes. But we'll still talk about these challenges, and we'll still say that, you know, when it comes to finally a contingent going, suddenly there's a lot of hype, media hype, everything is there. But when you look at the exact preparation, we are lacking in so many ways still. What needs to be done, actually?
See, there has been a lot of positive change. Like I was mentioning earlier, you know, when I started shooting, we didn't have a clue what we are doing. There were no coaches. There were coaches, but they were Indian coaches, and they were not proper equipment. Ammunition wasn't there. So I've seen in last about 7-8 years, we've come a long way. And had we not come a long way like this, we would have never won such so many medals. Now, whether you see Commonwealth Games, Asian Games, you know, shooters are really doing well and winning medals at all formats. The only reason for this is that we have evolved as a strong shooting nation over the years, and this would not have been possible without the support we have got from them.
Is it a rich man's sport?
Well, it used to be, not anymore, because now a lot of things are subsidized. Also, now the shooting ranges, they have guns available and everything.
Do you have enough shooting ranges? Are you okay and satisfied with it?
Well, we could do with more shooting ranges, because this is something which obviously needs to be looked at, because don't forget, we need large areas for shooting ranges. End of the day, you're handling guns, so you need a lot of empty spaces so that the pellets fall in the safe area. So in cities, we really can't have, because there's not much space. So there are ranges coming up. There are a lot of private ranges coming up. So as I'm saying, there is a change, but it's going to take time. You can't overnight expect ranges mushrooming everywhere over in the country. So there is a change, but I guess it's going to take at least a decade before we see this as one of the main sports.
So now you've got a position in Punjab Police also. How do you manage time?
Well, they've been very kind and nice to me. As long as I'm competing, I really don't have to go back and serve. So, but definitely after I decide to take retirement from the sport, I would definitely like to go and serve back in the Punjab.
And what is your message to all these youngsters who are also watching?
Well, I would just like to say one thing. If you have a dream, just chase it with determination and dedication. The sky is the limit.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ronjan Sodhi, for talking to us, and all the very best for whatever you do and whichever competition that you go to. And we know that you'll come back with flying colors. And that was Mr. Ronjan Sodhi talking to us in The Quest. Hope you liked this edition of The Quest. Keep watching. Namaskar and bye-bye.